How are you?
I'm good. Well, it's interesting because I'm now hitting that stride of sort of presenting the film, and it's nice. We did like Take Part Live yesterday. We're doing Katie Couric tomorrow. And it feels like the film is sort of reaching a certain momentum level, which is cool.
Is it lonely without a sidekick?
It is. I mean, I have to say, like, when David Carr was, you know, doing all of the press, it was amazing how much people were interested. I mean, it's almost like, you know, you're doing a film about the media. Mm-hmm. Every media outlet wants to know sort of what's in the film. So I look back on that experience and think like how blessed we were in a way with the amount of attention we got.
So are you feeling less attended this time? Or
I think that this film is tougher because it's about a topic that, I mean, in some ways is actually even more relevant to people because it hits their pocketbooks and, you know, many, you know, there's over 20 million people in the higher education sector. Mm-hmm. But the film is, has a lot of tough points, and so to grapple with them is difficult.
Well, I don't mean to be kissing your butt in this situation, but I do think it's the most important film I've seen on education, and since there was that wave of a bunch of films, of, you know, 5 years ago, mm-hmm. where there were three or four films that kind of all bunched together and similar about the lottery and things like that. Mm-hmm. But I mean, this is like a not only a good film, but I think a very important film for
Thank
people
you.
To see. I mean, and everybody really, from anybody who was anybody over as a baby, really, to the age of, you know, 60, is connection to this story in some way.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, I have kids that are 6 and 4, and my understanding is that by the time they're of college age, it will cost $500,000 to $550,000 for them. I mean, it's mind-boggling, and I think a lot of people who are parents are scared, which is what they're going to do. But it's so interesting to see now that sort of the option of not going to college is becoming more accepted, and sort of the stigma associated with that is changing. Although, as we see in the film, going to college is also such a key to the middle class and an engine of social mobility.
Though, who knows? I mean, that's the thing that's kind of magical about it. One of the things that was interesting watching the movie was I kept on thinking about Silicon Valley.
Mm-hmm.
All those guys bunched up in the, you know, in that house somewhere in Silicon Valley making, you know, hopefully making a fortune, they're praying. And just kind of skip, even though I guess they must have gone to school, but
absolutely, or they've been coding since they were in high school and they had access to that, and now they just want to go off with what they're doing. And it's really fascinating how the Bay Area is really a leader in this movement of un-college.
Yeah, when you would think it would be the opposite.
Well,
in some level.
Yeah, I guess there's a broader trend in that community to sort of not look at traditional markers of success or of prestige. Mm. And it's more about just what you can do.
Well, one of the things in the movie that's significant is the conversation about self-education.
Mm-hmm.
That it's not, that's now an option, which it wasn't 20 years ago.
Completely.
And I guess the coders are those kind of kids.
Exactly. I mean, and now you have things like Coursera, edX, and to a certain degree Udacity also, that are these courses that if you have the skill set to be able to focus on a video you're watching, do the quizzes and interact with people, and you enjoy that sort of peer-to-peer interaction online, mm-hmm. I mean, the world is sort of your oyster. You can do so much. But I think, you know, what we see in the film is for students who have difficulty focusing, who are taking like remedial courses as they did at San Jose State, it's devastating for them not to have that in-class instruction, somebody to literally like pat them on the back or you know, explain something to them.
Human contact is a irreplaceable
I think
thing.
So, yeah, absolutely.
So where did this, what was the very beginning of this for you?
The very beginning for me was sort of the tail end of the distribution of Page One, when that film was sort of nearing its end in its first incarnation, its first life. I thought, you know, what do I want to do next? I really enjoy sort of this this version of a Fred Wiseman thing that I do, which, you know, of course, even to compare it is kind of ridiculous because he's the master, and it's not 4 hours long.
And you're not nearly as cranky as Fred. Though I love Fred.
Yeah, I mean, he's amazing. Although at Berkeley is interesting because I have some questions about the way that it is, in my opinion, structured very much from the administration's perspective. Mm-hmm. And I think Ivory Tower is an interesting response to that film, to the extent that it sort of shows students seizing control back, mm-hmm. Even in the depiction of protests. You know, like at Berkeley, at the end, they have the student protest that the administration just sort of laughs off, and it sort of fizzles out very quickly. Mm-hmm. And instead, in Ivory Tower, we see the students of Cooper Union occupying the president's office for 65 days. So I think there's interesting tension to that, but
well, there's, in reverse as well. I mean, because it is interesting. The Cooper Union stuff in this movie is fantastic, and I kept telling people about to the story about it. Uh-huh. But at the same time, and how also there were people with the same red, you know, square.
Yes.
At Stanford at graduation and other places shown in the movie. But also, it's interesting to see the Stanford perspective, mm-hmm. Berkeley perspective, excuse me, in Fred's movie. You know, get a sense of what those guys who are sitting there grunting while the students yell at them are really thinking. And how they see that universe.
Absolutely. And Berkeley is another, you know, incredible symbol of what's happened to higher education. I mean, in the 60s, you could go there basically for free or for nominal fees. And today, you know, I think the tuition is about $14,000 or $12,000, not including room and board, which is another $12,000 to $14,000. So,
I have a nephew who's actually heading off to a U of C school this fall, and it's, I think, 26. Everything included, mm-hmm. for the crappiest. He's actually not even going to a good UC school. He's going to the low end of the UC program, and it's just as expensive. And mm-hmm. It's almost unimaginably expensive for not the best school.
Right. You know? I mean, as we see in the film, it's gone up 1,120% since 1978. More than food, more than healthcare. So it's a devastating problem, and when you factor debt into it, but basically, so my thinking was I wanted to do another film about an important cultural institution, so I was looking at sort of the landscape, and it was right at the time that student loan debt had exceeded $1 trillion, and Peter Thiel was starting but there was more attention around the mm-hmm. 20 under 20 fellowship, so I've had always a very positive, maybe nostalgic view of my own college education.
Which was where?
So I went to Yale and studied history for college, and have great friendships from that period and learned a lot. And of course, that serves me really well as a documentary filmmaker. Mm-hmm. And my parents were able to pay for me to go. So I don't have any regrets about my college experience, and I think when I saw so much negativity surrounding college, so many people saying, you know, you really don't have to go, it's too expensive, to me it sounded very similar to some of the conversations I had heard about the New York Times when Carlos Slim had invested in it and there were all these layoffs, and there were sort of people dancing on the grave, prematurely of course, for the New York Times. And so I thought, here's another sector where people have a lot of cynicism and would be happy to see schools transform in a way that might be destructive. Because also at this time, massive open online courses, the MOOCs, were being presented as the panacea and the replacement for professors in some cases. So I thought, okay, let's bring cameras on the ground in a range of universities and see what's really like. Is it as bad as people say?
So you'll be doing cord cutting next.
Right.
The next wave of the cynical, you know, life is changing, kill the cable system.
Exactly.
So were you? I mean, was there any kind of, besides the research that you started doing, was there anything else you were kind of creating as your foundation? Were there books or were there other people with voices in your, you know, talking in your ear, or
100%. There are so many great thinkers on this problem that appear in the film, and that's because I read their books, and so much of their insight informed me in the movie. Andrew DelBanco, who wrote College: What It Was, Is, and Should Be. Andy's sort of like the moral conscious of the film. Mm-hmm. And his book is all about the historical context of college in America, starting from Harvard in 1636, and this notion of the lecture as a sermon, as a way to sort of inspire students to go on to a meaningful life. Richard Arum and Joseph Rosca wrote the book Academically Adrift, which is sort of a study of academic performance and or underperformance in a range of schools, looking at how students are reading much less, writing much less, and drawing interesting connections between that and the university growing in a sort of corporate model and charging so much and treating students as customers, such that in the classroom there are like these perverse incentives that arise where the student says, you know, I'm here, I'm paying a ton of money, I don't want to do too much work, I want to have fun, and the professor wanting to do research to also curry favor with the administration and maintain their tenure and sort of be a rock star professor, and in many cases this resulting in grade inflation or students choosing classes and rating professors online in surveys in a way that sort of really changes the tough love kind of dynamic that probably we remember from when we were in college.
Well, it sounds like neither the student nor the professor wants to be there in the classroom teaching. That's like neither one of them wants to have anything to do with it.
Exactly.
I mean, I remember when I was a kid, which was a long time ago now, but I mean, I was at NYU and did not have a great college experience because I wasn't interested in college and kind of went because I was being asked to by my father who paid for it. But that was like the very early times when people were like starting to leave their quarters in freshman and sophomore classes and just listening, you know, theoretically listening to the recorder later and not even bothering attending the classes.
Wow.
And now I guess that's normal, because people are just looking at it online and are able to catch up with their classes, theoretically, the big giant lecture classes
right.
that have hundreds of people in them.
Well, and there is an argument that that lecture model just doesn't really work anymore, that having a professor sort of at the sage on the stage, who's in the front of the classroom, droning with students who are on their laptops, like on Facebook, that's, you know, who's benefiting from that? But that's a cynical view and a sort of limited view in the sense of, you know, what is the role of the professor? Because we also see in the film that professors, you know, either through office hours or other interactions with students are such an important model for them in terms of scholarship, and also even in a school like Deep Springs that we see a professor like taking interest in the student's life and sort of intervening to help them on an emotional problem. And that's kind of what we celebrate about the idea of college, that it's an opportunity for people to like become, transition from adolescence to adulthood.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think if people if that was really what the model was now for people, if that was the experience people were having, I think they complain less about the cost and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously the cost is a problem on different levels,
mm-hmm.
but I think much like cord cutting actually, or even the New York Times being at, you know, $2 or whatever at the newsstand, there's something about, there's like a finding the tipping point, not to phrase Malcolm Gladwell into the story, but to, you know, where you just go start going, well, is this really worth it? What am I paying for?
Right.
You know, when you start thinking about the price,
mm-hmm.
even if it's true with a movie or Broadway or anything else, if you start thinking about the price instead of enjoying the experience, then you're going to be a lot less likely to want to spend the money.
That's right. You sort of feel entitled to an array of sort of services as if the school is a service provider, mm-hmm. rather than a sort of academy in which you are finding mentors and sort of in a path of, you know, a journey of self-discovery.
And the irony is that I guess in those giant lecture classes, only actually the teachers who were actually great communicators could hold a room that large and make it interesting for an hour or an hour and a half, whereas those people were actually devalued by the system because they're not necessarily producing papers and, you know, not publishing.
Precisely, yeah.
It's craziness. You also, I think, deep. No, I'm forgetting the name.
Deep Springs.
Deep Springs. This movie, I think, could like start a whole series of Deep Springs, because Deep Springs is not nearly big enough for the number of people who are going to watch this movie and go,
right,
I need to send my kid there. and I think kids who want to have that experience also. It's like, you know, the military is no longer a very good option,
right,
or a very attractive option. Certainly, maybe we'll be out of the wars soon, and then we may be better again. But for all those kids, parents who thought their kids belonged in a more structured environment,
mm-hmm.
It's kind of an extraordinary and wonderful place.
Absolutely. I mean, it's the complete reverse of this environment in which students are, you know, going to climbing walls and sort of student centers and partying all the time. Deep Springs, it's, you know, it's in the desert of Death Valley, and all the students are able to govern the school, choose the classes, choose the professors, and also, you know, work on the ranch and support the place from the ground up.
Yeah. I think people have forgotten they like working.
It's true. Yeah. They enjoy being invested in this this project, which sort of keeps their whole school running.
Yeah. It's not quite. It is a weird thing, because it's like, as a parent, you wonder how to infuse that in your child. But I do think that the nature of people. I mean, I was for me, it's always like I think of my earliest jobs, where I worked the hardest and made the least, and those are the happiest. Some of the happiest working experiences I ever had.
Do you have kids?
I have a four-year-old.
A four-year-old.
Wow. So, and we're spending, you know, $16,000 a year for preschool. So,
right.
Anticipating
it's a long
how much
road.
More, you know, when you go to an elementary school trip and they say, you know, it's only $25,000. You're like, wow, thank you. first grade, perfect.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it goes up from there. It's like, I don't know how this works out ultimately.
It's really expensive.
Yeah. Do you live in Manhattan or?
We live in Brooklyn, and we also send both of our kids to a private school. My daughter's entering first grade next year. My son's in kindergarten, and it's tremendously expensive already.
Yeah. No, it's amazing how many people who work for like major jobs out here at studios and things are scared of spending that much kind of money. You know, everybody's like, that's a house, that's a second house. It's all going away.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to invest in that future. So what was the experience of actually making it? Were you constantly surprised, or had you done enough research that you were kind of filling in what you knew already? Or
it was very research-driven. It was complex just in terms of juggling all the different locations where we would film and working on a pretty tight schedule. We started in September of 2012, filming at Harvard, and getting access there was also sort of, you know, complicated. I think the level of access we have has, you know, people have told me it's unprecedented, because we're filming in the classroom, we're filming on campus, and they have actually really strict guidelines about shooting there at all.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently stemming from when they made Love Story on that campus, and like they won't allow tripods in the yard and. Mm-hmm.
You never hear about Harvard Film School, I guess.
Right. Well, actually, they have this VES program, Visual Ethnographic Studies.
Huh.
But it's more of a sort of anthropological approach to documentary. Mm-hmm. But we started there, and then in January of 2013, went to San Jose State, Arizona State, UVA, Spelman College, extending into the spring, and we were editing as we were shooting, so that we could be done by roughly, at least with an initial cut, September, October of 2013 to submit to Sundance.
And what was the Cooper Union circumstance of shooting?
Absolutely. So, well, Cooper Union was sort of on my radar, but not in a major way, even though I knew something big was happening there. And we were in San Francisco shooting on College when there was this front page article in the Times saying that an era had come to an end and Cooper Union was going to start charging.
Mm-hmm.
And that some students had occupied the president's office. I think that maybe that was like the day after, but so we were in San Francisco, so I thought, geez, I wish we were there in New York to be able to capture this. So we came back at the end of that week, and I just went right to the building, where the Great Hall is of Cooper Union, and I had seen Victoria Sobel in other photographs, and she has this distinctive dyed blonde and black hair down the middle. And so I sort of stalked the building waiting for her to come down, and then found her and interviewed her and talked about the project. And so we were sort of in the phase of already trying to put together a rough cut, because this was in May, I think. And so we were coming to the conclusion of our production, but we knew we had to continue to follow that story.
So did you give some of the kids cameras? Because there are some actually like multiple shots.
Yes.
Where you're going, wow, they have a lot of crew.
Well, actually, the Mauricio Higuera is one of the main activists organizing the occupation, and he had a 5D that he was shooting. So we were able to get footage from him. So literally as they're walking up the stairs and when they take over, we get that immediate view, and so we really relied on that.
That's kind of a wonderful find.
Definitely.
And the other thing, the other question on the Cooper Union thing that I had during the movie was, there was no kind of like sell the building theme going on. Is there a reason why they can't just sell the building?
You know,
the second building?
Certainly people have suggested that, but for some reason they, I think, have not been able to find somebody who would want to buy it. And there's another building that's in the North Cooper Square that has been on the market for a long time. I think that might be part of it, is the fact that that building has not sold. So it's like there's a glut already in that sort of four block radius of buildings, and so I don't think they could find a buyer.
Well, I don't want to give away the whole thing, but is the math of it all? I mean, because the movie makes it pretty clear. It evolves into a pretty clear math that there is an answer to how this happened or why this happened, perhaps. Is it really that clean, or was that simplified for the film a little bit? Or,
well, the math is complicated, and there's a lawsuit, actually, that was just launched last week to sue the administration and the school for financial mismanagement. I mean, the one thing that is clear is that the mortgage payments on that loan for that building are $10 million a year. And that is far in excess of what they would get from charging tuition of the 1,000 students there. Mm-hmm. So it's clear that that's the straw that's breaking the camel's back. And then in terms of all the other financial sort of shenanigans, like investing in hedge funds, the judgment to take out the loan that they did at the interest rate that they did, all of that involves a lot of he said, she said about, you know, who was making the decisions and why. Mm-hmm.
So have you gotten much pushback from anybody besides ASU? Because I definitely can imagine they're not very happy with the film.
I've heard a couple of things from Cooper Union, but I'm not sure whether they've seen it yet. You know, it hasn't really been available in New York except in one or two very limited screenings.
The president won't be happy.
I'm not sure what the president's view will be. I mean, we did a 3-hour interview with him, and it, you know, obviously it was a very tense moment for him. I think that he believes he's in the right, and so we represented his take on everything. So, you know, who knows?
It's an interesting phenomenon because it really does feel like, I mean, it's part of the premise of the movie, I guess, but it does almost feel like, you know, Marissa Mark coming to Yahoo, or, you know, somebody moving from one area of the business into another and just coming in as a CEO and doing the things CEOs do now in corporations, even though this happens to be a higher education
situation. Well, and that's sort of the thesis of the film, is that universities are becoming more like big businesses, and so they're treating the students like customers, and so there's this ripple effect that is really destroying, in many cases, the educational ideal.
So are people coming to you and saying they're shocked, or are we all too embarrassed? I feel a little embarrassed because I kind of like it all. Once you see the film, it all makes sense. all the constant building at USC and UCLA and wherever locally, but also all over NYU, which I went to NYU when it was like one third the size it seems to be now. Mm-hmm. It seems like that's their business now, and it's kind of shocking when you see it all put together.
Well, I think that's the key, is putting it all together, because we see so many disparate articles about the statistics that you actually make a lot of money or more money by going to college, and yet student loan debt has become such a problem. And I think what this film does is not necessarily break news about this problem, but rather put everything together in a way that you kind of understand the context, and it is shocking when you view it that way. So that's hopefully what we're contributing to the conversation, is like putting it all in one big tent.
Well, it's been a running joke for me for all these years that, you know, oh, NYU is eating Greenwich Village, and they took over another block, they took over another block, they took over another theater I used to go to, and because it's a regular theater, now it's an NYU theater, and it's like, and now it's not quite as funny.
Right.
But I guess I know why they're sending me such elaborate requests for funding every year. Because they're like pitching condos practically.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of horrifying.
Definitely.
Is Yale exempt from this at all, or do you feel like there's the finger of this floating there too?
You know, we wanted to shoot at Yale. particularly in their new, they have a new school called Yale NUS in Singapore, and it's part of a broader trend of universities starting arms like NYU in foreign locations. Mm-hmm. Pericles Lewis is the president of that school, and he had a lot of, we spoke to him, he had a lot of very idealistic notions about how they could interact with the community in Singapore and stuff, and I think there would have been interesting tensions and questions to explore there. Ultimately, it didn't work out. And certainly I wouldn't say that those schools are exempt, but the one thing that they do is they provide full need financial aid. So as we say in the beginning of the film, Harvard and Yale and others are part of this 1.25%.
Which represents about how many schools? You
know? So out of about 4,400 or so, it's about 60 schools that if you make below $60,000, if your family makes below $60,000, they'll pay for everything. If mm-hmm. they make below 100 or 120, they'll pay for everything but 10%. They're complicated calculations. Mm-hmm. However, they have the endowment and the resources and the commitment to provide that kind of support for their students. So even though, yes, they are participating in a campaign to grow bigger and better, in some ways it's hard to fault them for that because they're also spending so much of their resources on making sure to attract as many people who wouldn't be able to afford it. Mm-hmm. I think the problem that we see and that Clayton Christensen in the movie explains is that there are other schools that don't have that endowment and don't have that same commitment to financial aid that are then mimicking those elite schools and their attempt to grow bigger. Mm-hmm. And then putting more money into things like dormitories and in some cases research facilities that they don't need to attract certain rock star professors that increase their prestige and their brand, but all in a way that makes tuition rise and without providing that kind of aid to the student. So if you're a student going to one of those schools because of those reasons, you can emerge with this outrageous student debt that is just paralyzing you.
One, and certainly it's become an issue, diversity 40 years after busing started. It's amazing how diversity in a city like Los Angeles or even in New York, that it's still such a problematic thing for schools, whether elementary schools or mm-hmm. colleges or anything else. It's just hard to, and that's something I think that a lot more parents want for their kids, is to have some semblance of a real universe that they live in instead of the ivory tower. Mm-hmm. As it were, but that seems to be a big financial challenge for these schools, I guess.
Creating diversity.
Yeah.
Right.
Allowing for diversity, creating, the financial possibilities of diversity.
Exactly.
Unless somebody goes into it looking forward to defaulting on their loan or something 4 years later, 5 years later.
Right.
Just how do you do it? But that would be the next moment.
Well, it's true, and inequality as part of this whole look at higher education is something that we spoke to Anthony Carnevale about. He appears in the film. He's the head of the Center on Workforce and Education at Georgetown. And he has a theory that college, because it is so necessary to get certain employment in our economy, actually, I think in his words, he says, like, launders class difference and racial difference, in the sense that so many of the students who aren't on a track to go to college are African American or Latino and disadvantaged financially. And so for those students who don't go to college, they are effectively laundered out of an entry to the middle class. And so he also says, the only thing worse than going to college is not going to college, in the sense that you're sort of participating in this system that actually leaves a lot of people out of the American dream, even as it is still this engine of social mobility. So as I'm expressing it, it's very complicated.
Within the film, because the film also argues that, as we talked about at the beginning, that, there is the argument for not participating also at this
precisely
point.
Right.
So it does swing both, and each individual, I guess, has their own story,
right?
Ultimately,
and then the film is like a launching point for these conversations. And for example, Frank Bruni wrote a column, an op-ed, a couple of weeks ago, taking off on that theme of inequality, which is also such a huge topic in all kinds of conversations today, and using the film as a sort of starting point to discuss that.
Yeah, Reagan is looking worse and worse. It's an interesting thing. If you look at the documentaries that are coming out, there's like every year now there's another one that kind of like reminds us that everything was actually a lot better before he became president, and the philosophy of not funding anything.
It is fascinating. I mean, that's one of the things that I also understood even more in making the film is this trajectory from the New Deal to the Great Society of Lyndon Johnson. You know, this country is so on this path of providing more and more opportunity until that period in the 70s and 80s when conservative governors start to reduce funding for certain things, and then you have Reagan, you know, take office as president, and everything changes. All the line graphs spike in that period.